cuisine is Italy's gift to the world. From top to toe, the map of Italy is a patchwork of gastronomic treasures that come not from a tradition of great chefs, but from beloved family recipes. Italy is the home of slow food, and Italian cuisine is largely about regional cooking. From one region to the next, produce, recipes, and traditions vary. Labels like DOP, DOCG, and IGP guarantee that certain products are harvested from a specific area and made by local farmers and artisans. But labels aside, the essence of Italian cuisine is in its simplicity. In how a few modest ingredients can come together to create something magical. And this is what keeps us coming back for more. Do come and join me. Let's get to know the people behind the produce. Let's step inside Italian kitchens. Let's eat the best of Italy, from top to toe. I'm Margarita Forrest, and this is My Italy. The city of Matera in the Basilicata region of southern Italy is one of two cities that have been selected as 2019's European Capital of Culture. Impressive title, right? But not nearly as impressive as actually being here and taking in all this natural beauty. It's almost like being on another planet. Or another era, because Matera is one of the few continuously inhabited settlements in the world, dating back to some 7,000 years ago.
Grazie.
Prego, prego.
Buongiorno Margherita, welcome, nice to see you.
Grazie Michele. Michele Centonze is the Director of Sales and Marketing at the fabulous Sextantio Le Grotte della Civita.
Welcome to Sextantio Le Grotte della Civita. Are you ready for a cave experience?
Oh my
gosh.
For
an authentic experience?
I am so excited.
Come with me.
This is just so amazing. I want to cry. It's just too beautiful.
Well.
Oh my God. I'm speechless. Oh, this is going to be my home. Hi.
Yes. It will be your home.
It's so beautiful.
Well, Margherita, Sextantio is more a cultural project. The owner, a philosopher of Swedish, of Italian, decided to invest his money to study with anthropologists, archaeologists, local residents and local artisans how to recreate the life inside.
Oh my gosh, that's so remarkable.
Sextantio is the vision of Daniele Kilgren, a philanthropist and hotelier who, over a period of 10 years, meticulously restored 18 caves and converted them to luxury hotel rooms.
Well, oh my gosh. Have to imagine that in this cave, people used to live since Paleolithic age till 1952. Now you can continue that history. As you can see from chairs, table, from the beds, everything is coming from the past, from the original houses of the Sassi and Southern Italy. So we try to recreate the same atmosphere, the same layout, the same feeling of the past. We also number the stones. We put stones out. We put plumbings, pipes, electricity, and so on, heating, all that, and we put stones back at the same place. So
incredible.
Yeah, it's all hidden.
Imagine that, numbering every single stone so that each one is put back where it originally was. At Sextantio, you have all the modern conveniences you can think of, but it's all hidden away.
Well, apart from the Philippe Starck bathtub and shower, of course.
That's what I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, it's part of the experience. Everything is coming from the past. Baths, linens, of course.
I'm just so looking forward to the experience. Grazie, Michele.
Grazie a te. Enjoy, Margarita. Enjoy your stay.
Michele leaves me in my cave and there is silence. I take a minute to say thank you to the universe for this unique experience. It's not difficult to slip back in time as my eyes adjust to the dimness of my cave. And by back in time, I mean the Stone Age. Entire families lived here, animals as well. There is history, there is energy, there is humanity. With a view. What more can a girl ask for?
Buongiorno, signora.
Do you like a cappuccino, American coffee?
For me, un doppio caffè. Per favore, sì. Grazie. Good morning from Sextantio in Matera. Buongiorno to all of you. This is just absolute magic.
This is breakfast Sextantio style. Under the sheltering sky, in the blinding light of the Italian sunshine. Across Sextantio is the spectacular Murgia Park, an even more ancient part of Matera. If you look closely enough, you will see caves carved out of the stone mountain. This is my backdrop to my breakfast of champions.
And look at this, I can even have my own freshly cracked walnuts. Okay. This is a beautiful bruschetta made with Matera bread. And Matera bread is one of the DOP breads from Italy. They're super known for it. And you can have it actually grilled or not grilled, but I like it as a bruschetta. And of course, I'm going to have it with just a little bit of burrata. Ooh, grazie. Grazie, signora. Did you see that? The burrata just oozed out. Yummy. This is the best area for burrata. So, I mean, what an enjoyable thing to be able to have a beautiful little fresh one for breakfast. You all know about the tomatoes in Italy, so.
Take your pick from any of the many rustic tables set out in the deck of Sextantio. Time stops here and really allows you to commune with nature.
I have to toast to the heavens and say thank you for this wonderful, wonderful gift.
For a first timer to Matera, I do recommend that you get a tour guide.
Hi, Stefania, nice to meet you.
Me too, my pleasure.
Unlike other Italian cities, Matera is not as popular yet, so English-speaking tour guides are few and far between. I'm lucky to have booked Stefania on such short notice. Matera was once the shame of Italy, and with Stefania telling me the story, I understand it more. She tells me Matera was once one of the most desolate parts of Italy. Even Italians didn't know about it until Jewish painter, doctor, and anti-fascist Carlo Levi, when exiled in Basilicata, wrote a memoir about his time here. It was called God Stopped at Eboli and was published in 1945.
Wow, this is so beautiful!
The title suggests that Christianity and civilization stopped in Eboli, a town near Naples, and never made it to Matera. He was shocked by the living conditions in Matera, so much so that he described it as Dante's Inferno. There was widespread disease and poverty, with multiple families living 20 to a cave together with their animals. The book caused such an outrage that it was given national attention. Residents were relocated, and for decades the Sassi remained abandoned until it was revived in the 1980s, and in 1993 it was designated a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Today, Matera is undergoing a renaissance as its once abandoned caves are being converted into shops, art galleries, restaurants, and hotels. In the middle of all the activity going on, our fossil remains frozen in time.
There is a sea sponge. Look how many here coming out.
All the shells.
And the sands. This is all sands.
This suggests that the entire city of Matera was underwater some 2 million years ago.
Matera, if we see Matera from the top, has got a particular shape. Looks like a bird, like a pigeon. Oh. Where the body is represented by the cathedral, instead the two wings are the two districts called Sassi. This one is Sasso Barisano. Instead, on the other side, we have Sasso Caveoso. So
it's like water. Two wings,
yeah, two
like
wings.
This, and the cathedral like in the middle. Okay.
For Sassi, are these kinds of houses built one on top of the other. Before, people were living just in small caves, but when they had the right material, they could cut this stone and build one on top of the other. So if you translate the word Sassi, means stone.
Okay.
But always from taking from under. The underneath.
The Sassi, or the oldest part of Matera, is a winding maze of streets and houses with no clear beginning or end. To orient yourself, look for the highest spot, Civita Hill, on which the Cathedral of Santa Maria della Bruna stands. The cathedral was built in the Romanesque Apulian style between 1230 and 1270.
Beautiful.
And this church is turned on Jerusalem way.
Towards Jerusalem, facing Jerusalem.
Before was on the other side. As you can see, we have the door, the lion's door.
The old entrance was there.
That one, yeah.
From any vantage point, Matera looks like the perfect movie set. And it's no wonder that so many movies have been filmed here. James Bond, I hear, is filming as we speak.
Oh, you know that Mel Gibson came here?
Yeah, The Passion of Christ.
The Passion of Christ, and he's coming again in a few months to do the sequel of The Passion.
Oh.
And there, I've done 3 years ago, the revisitation of Ben-Hur with Morgan Freeman, and the beginning of Wonder Woman, and the Maria Magdalena are the last movies that I've done
in this area.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for showing me the heart of Matera. It means so much to me. It's been a really, really fulfilling and heartwarming experience listening to you and learning so much about the anima of this beautiful place. Grazie.
Thank you. To you, it's my pleasure.
Stefania and I say our goodbyes as the sun sets and the stone houses slowly light up. Michele Castelli and Virginia Caravita are a match made in kitchen heaven. These are the young chefs behind the highly imaginative Dimura Ulmo in Matera. Both protégés of Massimo Bottura, they bring experience and creativity with them to Dimura Ulmo. Dimura Ulmo is a restored palazzo in the middle of the Sassi. It's a mix of classic and modern, with high arched ceilings painted in ornate fashion and modern art completing the look. Step outside to a beautiful stone terrace to enjoy a spectacular 360-degree view. This may be an 18th century palazzo, but the kitchen of Michele and Virginia is definitely 21st century. Their cuisine is a modern twist on local ingredients and recipes from the region of Basilicata. The ingredients Michele and Virginia have chosen to work with today are bacala or cod, black chickpeas, and Cusco pepper.
Cod skin, dried also, and milk.
And milk.
Yeah, exactly. Now Michele is cleaning the cod and he's keeping away the belly of the cod. And also he will keep away the skin.
Just like most Italian dishes, guarda, only 5 ingredients. Very simple, no?
Absolutely, yes. We think that kitchen has to be simple, but with very high quality ingredients.
So exactly.
I'm surprised to discover that cod is a common ingredient in the mountains of Basilicata. And the reason is quite interesting.
Because it's a salty fish, so it has a long life. Okay. People from Matera used to go near the sea and change goat, sheep with the fish.
So like barter.
Exactly.
While the women chat, Chef Michele has already cut and cleaned the cod and scraped off the skin.
And now we have to put them in the dryer.
And look at that, waste nothing, no?
No, nothing.
You have to use everything.
Yeah, exactly.
The cod skin goes into the dehydrator and will remain there for 3 days at 60 degrees.
Ah, so like a potato chip, no? Come patatine.
Please, come here to cut.
Okay.
You have to help us.
I have to earn my meal, so I help out with the kitchen prep. The cod goes into a pot and is covered with milk.
And now we are putting the milk till covering all the cod fish.
See, just salted cod and milk.
When it will start to boil, we will switch it off, because the fish has not to be overcooked, but it has to remain soft.
The next ingredient is black chickpeas, or cecineri, very common in the area. Just cover in water and add olive oil.
Così?
Perfect.
And loro.
The chickpeas need a couple of hours on the stove to soften. Michele says for this recipe, you need patience.
Ah, so this is the finished product of the...
Exactly, this is the finished product. We just blended them and just put a little bit of salt.
Okay.
And stop. And we have this.
Beautiful.
Almost like squid ink, and a great contrast to the white cod.
Ooh la la.
Exactly.
Ooh.
That's the dehydrated cod skin being deep fried.
Crocante.
Yes. Now it's so crispy.
Ooh, and now the peppers.
Just clean the pepper.
Okay.
Water after, it's very
dangerous.
Ah, when you fry.
Exactly, you don't need to have water.
Whoa! Ooh la la!
Okay.
Like a balloon!
Exactly.
Right?
It's the same.
No. me? Okay. So I'll be the one? Okay.
Put in the oil, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and outside. And put under the oil.
Okay, so we're gonna do this.
Okay, perfect. Okay. Push it down.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Look!
Amazing!
It blew up like a balloon. Amazing! I can imagine how delicious this is.
The cod is done, and together with some milk and just a little salt, it is transferred to the mixer. The leftover milk, Michele says, will be used to boil pasta.
They really don't throw anything.
To create a cod mousse, olive oil is added to the milk and cod mixture. Some of the best olive oil in Italy comes from Basilicata and nearby Puglia.
Oh my gosh.
You wanna try?
Yes.
A little bit in the chiller because it has not to take humidity. How much is tasty?
The flavor of the pepper is so intense but sweet. And then just with a little bit of salt, it like brings the umami up.
And it's not spicy.
No,
absolutely. You cannot find it outside from the region, this kind of.
And they sell it like strung up in whole.
Exactly.
In whole pieces.
Exactly.
Okay. I'm gonna go look for it.
Absolutely, because
I have to put it in my suitcase.
The bacalà mantecato is done.
Wow.
And after, it has to rest a little bit because all the ingredients has to mix
together.
Exactly.
And it's nice because it's still a little coarse, no?
Yeah.
It still has a little texture.
It may be a recipe with only 5 ingredients, but it's the best 5 ingredients available. Not to mention the meticulous preparation that went into making this dish. From dehydrating the skins of the cod, to boiling the black beans for hours, to creating a cod mousse, and to frying up those beautiful pepperoncini crusco, it's science, technique, and restraint. And the result, an absolutely elegant cod cream dish in black chickpea puree, topped with crispy cod skin and a deeply intense brittle of peperoncino crusco. A true work of art.
Hi.
Wow. Thank you. This is our bacalà mantecato that we made earlier. I'm so excited to try it. Flavor of the bacalà, so delicious and creamy, and the cecchi as well. And I'm going to take a bite of the croccante. Maybe put a little bacalà on it. Mmm. Che delizioso. Cin cin.
There's a Salvador Dali exhibit, and it's part of the many activities celebrating the city being named 2019's European Capital of Culture. I'm so thankful I'm seeing Matera now, while it's still, in a way, Italy's best-kept secret.
Matera, 2019's European Capital of Culture. You truly got me at the heart. I'll be back soon. Torno presto. Cin cin.